All right, welcome to Useful Idiots. I'm Matt Taibbi.
And I'm Katie Halper. And this is Useful Idiots. And if you can't tell what the name of the show is, I have a mug that proves it. And it says Useful Idiots on it. It says Useful Idiots with Matt Taibbi and Katie Halper, Rolling Stone, and 2 stars.
That's all the proof that we need that we are here, and that is actually the name of the show.
And why am I bringing this up, ladies and gentlemen? Because we need to spread awareness about so many things, including this show. So the way you can do that is if you order one of these mugs. Does this sound like... The sad thing is I don't make any money from this. That's what's so sad.
Yeah, no, it's
like,
so...
Why am I pitching this so hard?
It's so weird. Yeah, you're really intense about it.
It's a movement.
Yeah. Well, I'm not going to get in the way of it. I mean, it's you should pitch away.
You know, coffee even tastes better in this mug.
Well, I don't have one. All I have is a Snoop Dogg mug, so... Yeah. But we got to get through it. We got to move past it because we have the most important story in the history of media to talk about, which is, and I think everybody knows what that is. So we don't have to bring it up now.
We don't have to bring it up. Let it. It'll pop up later in the show.
It'll pop up on its own, and then we will touch upon it.
We'll have to touch upon it. And honestly, we haven't done enough of a deep dive, so it's just going to be the tip. It'll be just the tip of the story. But we can't stop it from rearing its head. You can look away, but it's going to be there.
That's right. And if, of course, you probably know what we're talking about, or maybe not.
What else could that apply to?
I don't know. Lots of things. There actually were lots of other things that happened in the world this week.
Yeah, but none that cast such a shadow.
Right. Yes, exactly. All right. Well, let's do the four food groups. Democrats suck. Republicans suck. Isn't that terrible? Isn't that weird? And I'm up, right?
Yeah.
All right. One of the big story this week, as of this moment, it'll probably change 10 times before this actually goes out on the internet. But obviously the release of the Hunter Biden archive, the New York Post story, which was controversial for several reasons, right? Including, unfortunately, we didn't get to talk to our last guest, Antonio Garcia Martinez, formerly of Facebook, about this. But the decision by Facebook and Twitter to suppress that story, it was, I thought, kind of an amazing moment in history of modern media. And now we're into this sort of second phase of the story. And the interesting thing about, there's a couple interesting things about it, but the Biden camp didn't deny the veracity of any of this material right away, which is a big deal. If anybody's ever done one of these exposés, you're always holding your breath in the first 5 to 6 hours after you release it. Because even sometimes if you have a true story, the target of the story will deny that it's real. And then it creates this whole dynamic that, puts everything into question. And the fact that they didn't do this was significant.
Can you, Matt, sorry, just because it was a very centered story, can you set it up for listeners and viewers who may not know what these materials are that came out?
Yeah, absolutely. So the story is that Hunter Biden, who obviously is Joe Biden's son, who has some issues, ostensibly he left a laptop to be repaired at a certain place and never picked it up. And the owner of the store somehow eventually got that laptop into the hands of people like Rudy Giuliani. And on that laptop is a lot of stuff. It's amazing that the secondary headline is Hunter Biden allegedly smoking crack and having sex and with photos. The sort of top line story had to do with communications he had with executives from the Ukrainian energy company Burisma. And the worst thing in it was basically the implication that Hunter had introduced his father to an executive from Burisma because Burisma was looking for Hunter to, quote, use his influence to help them get out from under basically bribe demands from the Ukrainian government. So very ugly story, right? And if true, it contradicts things that Joe Biden has said before, kind of messes with the timeline of this whole Hunter Biden story a little bit, as reported. But again, nobody disputed the veracity of it. And then they moved into this phase immediately where both members of the media and politicians started calling it a Russian disinformation campaign, completely without any evidence at all.
Right.
And the worst offender of this, and Dan, if we could see the story, was Adam Schiff. You know, Adam Schiff is really, you know, he's the like a walking definition of political mediocrity, this guy.
Yeah.
And he's basically been the Democrats' hatchet man throughout the kind of Russiagate period. Has repeatedly said things that were demonstrably untrue. And the press keeps giving him, you know, a place to say these things.
Right.
I mean, he went back. He was the person who told us that there was more than circumstantial evidence of collusion once upon a time. He was the person who came out and said that the Nunes memo about FISA abuse was completely incorrect. And he turned out to be wrong about that. And now he's come out and basically, if Dan, if we can see the story, the quote from Schiff, the Schiff quote is, "We know this whole smear on Joe Biden comes from the Kremlin. Clearly, the origins of this whole smear are from the Kremlin, and the president is only happy to have Kremlin help in trying to amplify it." And then he repeats, "I think we know who the driving force behind the smear has been all along, and it's been the president and the Kremlin. The Kremlin has an obvious..." Like, okay, we get
it. Wait, I thought he knew. Now he thinks?
Yeah. Yeah, and he yeah. just kept going on and on and on and on about this. And
let's just be clear, there is much more evidence that Hunter Biden did this than there is evidence that it was Russians.
Yeah, I don't really see the evidence that of Russian disinformation. I
right.
mean, there's a remote possibility that there's some involvement in getting this material to Giuliani, which would be a different thing. And it's been frustrating to see people not understand the difference between disinformation or misinformation and, you know, adverse information, right? Or dirt
right,
or something
right,
like that.
Right, right, yeah.
But, you know, this is Schiff's role. He's basically the guy who gets up on television and says the thing that just has no evidence or backing whatsoever. And, you know,
right.
and he's been doing this for 4 years. So it was so conspicuous when they didn't invite him to the convention because, you know, he's like the black sheep of the party right now.
Yeah.
He's the person they get to do all the hatchet work. And anyway, so that,
has
that
nothing
was
nothing to show for it, sadly.
Well, yeah, I mean, right. Yeah, they might win this election.
No, you're right. But I meant in terms of the impeachment stuff not being very featured in the DNC, at the DNC.
Right, that or the Russiagate thing never going, I mean, they obviously plan for that to be an impeachment case.
Yeah. Right, right, right. I mean, you know, what's interesting is that, and then I do kind of want to get back into what this show is about Hunter Biden, because I actually think that they really botched a lot of this oppo. But what's interesting is that the Dems are so used to using Russiagate as an excuse for anything, that they don't realize they're actually not doing good defense. Like, they're not spinning this effectively because mm-hmm. they're admitting this is true by not denying it. And it's so, I think anyone who's, again, Trump, I'm pretty sure is going to lose, so it's a moot point. But if it were still up for grabs, and who knows, it's like everyone sees through this as bullshit. Like, no one who isn't already anti-Trump would ever see this and be like, well, you know, this is probably Russian disinformation, so we're going to ignore it. And in the meantime, there's a lot you could say and use this as an opportunity to say. Now, one of the ironies of this is that we see the Dems again being so out of touch with what matters to most, to politically unengaged people, let's say, people who aren't already hardcore Dems or hardcore Trump haters. They always go to Russiagate. And as much as, you know, obviously Biden supporters really circle the wagons around that, but it's not a very effective, I mean, I think other people though really see through it as a BS, as like just a PR move. And they're not dealing with the allegations. And, you know, it's not like, this is not a court of law where you get to not, where things are inadmissible because of the way they were presented, right? Like when there's, you know, when you get things through an illegal search, for instance, that's different. Like this, the way this came out really doesn't matter, because that's what happens in politics. And you can think that the other people who did that are like dicks for doing that, but it happens all the time.
Right.
And one of the pieces that I think is not effective, Oppo, is the text exchange where Hunter, I think, comes out as very sympathetic and Biden comes out as very compassionate. Hunter's like, I'm such a fuck up. I'm a, you know,
ruining your political career.
Yeah, right? I'm ruining your political career. It's interesting because then he's like, Dad, you have to run. You gotta run, or else like I can't. I don't want to ruin. He basically really encourages Joe Biden to run, which is kind of funny.
It is funny.
And then he's like, "Yeah, I'm gonna call you later today to talk about running." But the part that's kind of sweet is that he's like, "I wish I was there for you, my beautiful boy. You know, I love you." And that part is like the compassionate part. The problem with that part is that it undermines, or it's in great contrast with Biden's policy, his career. With the, you know, all the
his treatment of people nonviolent drug offenders,
right? Exactly. Every major crime bill has the senator, you know, has the senator from Delaware's name on it. And remember, famously, when we found Joe Biden's very good motto slogan, which probably is better than Build Back Better, which was Find the rationale.
Yep.
And that was when he was talking about like the RAVE Act, right, which allowed people. It was like one of the many things he did that was totally draconian. And again, the crime bill and locking up people. So he's ruined the lives. He's helped ruin the lives of people who have done what Hunter did. And Hunter got rehab and compassion, which is what everyone should get, honestly, when they're struggling with addiction. So that's the bad part. It's not that he was nice to his son. I mean, I think Republicans are so, like, some of them are just so craven and draconian that they think this is, like, embarrassing.
Well, yeah, I mean, they're trying to make a connection about the Burisma story that they don't quite have. Right. And so that people understand, I mean, the Burisma story it's bad. And it's not necessarily bad about Joe Biden. It's really bad about Hunter Biden, because I think when people probably, they use words like nepotism, this is what people do, they cash in on their family name. This is different. This company, just so that people understand the timeline, in 2014, after the Euromaidan revolution, basically they kicked out all of the oligarchs who had been in the Ukrainian government, who were surrounding the sort of pro-Russian leader Yanukovych. One of them was this guy Mykola Zlochevsky, who had a number of different titles, including ecological minister under Yanukovych. What he basically did in office was give himself oil development licenses that he then privatized directly into his own hands through this company, Burisma. He also allegedly, right, and this is what some of the criminal cases allege, is that he took licenses from existing businesses and basically handed them to himself. So he's a thief, basically. This is a mob enterprise, Burisma. When Zlochevsky got kicked out of office, they immediately went around and started hiring well-known Western people to put on the board of directors, because they knew they were about to face all of these efforts to try to re-seize their property, their stolen property. And so this is within a month of the revolution. They put the former president of Poland, the college roommate of John Kerry's stepson, Devin Archer, the sitting secretary of state, right, at the time, and Hunter Biden on the board. And it's a protection racket. They hired these guys to try to ward off attempts to reclaim stolen money. That's right. What this was about. And so if there's any kind of connection at all between Hunter Biden trying to get his father to intervene in any way, then that's an order of magnitude worse. But it's already a really bad story. It just it bothers me that people keep playing down that aspect of it. You don't have to be like, you don't have to love Trump to recognize that this is a bad thing, you know?
And so just to clarify, what makes it already bad? Which part of it is already bad?
The fact that he was making $83,000 a month. What was that money for? That money was for to buy the appearance of American protection. That's all that was for.
Right.
So that other banks in other countries wouldn't seize their assets. Other countries wouldn't prosecute.
Right.
Et cetera, et cetera.
It is such gross nepotism. But the way that people should be responding is pointing out what Trump has, although Trump really does get away with hypocrisy in a way that no one else does. I always make this point, because his hypocrisy isn't hypocritical. There's so much to point to with his kids.
Yes, absolutely. But this would be equivalent to taking money from like the very worst, like Saudi actors, for instance, right? Like the people I talked to this week, they had, there were, it sounds like 13 or 14 different criminal cases involving this company just in the last 3 or 4 right. years. I'm just saying that this is, it's worse than being on the board of Amtrak for,
yes,
you know.
Yes, right. The so, other like, thing by a lot. The other yeah. thing that he's done, he should have yeah. stuck, he really should have just tried to get on the board of Greyhound.
Right.
Peter Pan.
Anyway, we've gone on about that.
But it's important. I think it's a really important story and there's so many layers of it. And what are the things that, I mean, Trump's kids, like you have Jared Kushner, the big irony is that, you know, the one thing where there was Michael Flynn, like colluding with a foreign government was when he asked the Russian ambassador to get Russia to vote against that resolution condemning Israel for
right.
building settlements. Right. Mm-hmm. And that was apparently at the behest of Jared.
Mm-hmm.
And so, but because it's so, again, this is like the chickens coming home to roost, or like the Russiagate chickens coming home to roost, or the Israel alliance coming home to roost. Like, that's not a convenient thing for people to bring up because it involves Israel.
Right, right. And clearly the Ivanka and Jared Kushner have massively enriched themselves through their association with their father and through their time in office. And that all of that is fair game, right?
Right, it is, yeah.
So, but you can't use that to say that this isn't a story. That's all.
No, I agree, of course. And it also, there's an art to it because you don't want to look like, well, yeah, I cheated, but look at the way this guy cheated even worse.
Right.
But that kind of is the most effective argument. And I just think it's ironic that it's so funny that like people who really think that they're experts in Russiagate, like if you ask them what they think about Israel, the Israeli question, they're like, what do you mean? I'm not talking about that. It's like, wait, it's literally probably one of the most important parts of it.
Right. Yeah.
But again, it's not politically convenient because people don't want to. Like,
no, they want to isolate the narrative and make it all about one thing that's just clean and it's not. None of this is.
Yes.
So, yeah.
And ironically, again, because Putin, you know, because Russia did not agree, that undermines the argument about like Putin and, you know, it undermines the bromance argument because Putin right. didn't agree. So either they have an S&M relationship.
Yeah, it's complicated, right? Yeah.
It's a messy thing. It doesn't really support Russiagate, which is why, but it does support attempted collusion, right?
For sure. Absolutely.
Which is so funny. So, but the Dems just didn't want to build their case around that.
No,
so.
They clearly have an argument with other countries. Israel.
Right. Oh, and we didn't even talk about the censorship part. So that's the other thing, which is that, you know, big tech totally showed its true, you know, its colors this week by last week. And it was really painful, I have to admit, to do our interview with Antonio. And right after we finished that, this thing blew up.
Yeah.
It's almost like Twitter and Facebook planned it that way.
They did. Actually, I think we even said off the air that was going to happen.
Yeah. So the other part of the story is that you couldn't share that. It appeared in the New York Post, this story originally, and you couldn't share that link.
Yeah. Facebook and Twitter took two different approaches. Facebook was preventing people from sharing it. Basically, temporarily, they were saying, until they could verify the contents. And Twitter went and they blocked the account of the White House Press Secretary, Kayleigh McEnany. They prevented people from seeing it entirely on multiple grounds, on the grounds that it was hacked material. And they also said it was a doxing issue. I actually reached out to some people at the company that night. And they said that even if the hacking issue hadn't been there, they would have banned it for the doxing issue because there was private information in some of those emails. But the issue is that they didn't do this for 4 years worth of illegally leaked, dubious, unproven, unverified stories. The biggest example being probably anything related to the Steele dossier, which would, you know, they put out, you know, back in 2017. And of course, there were stories that were based on it before then, but there was never any intervention with any of those P-tape type stories, which turned out to be, you know, much more dubious than they looked at the time. So, you know, people are going to look at that and they're going to say there's an obvious double standard. That's been my objection to this thing the whole time. There's no way you can possibly do this censorship thing in a way that's going to be equitable.
Right.
You know?
Yeah. And also it's like, I was thinking about this, like, you know, this means that once you let big tech intervene, it's totally dangerous. it's things like the attacks on WikiLeaks or on, you know, journalists who deal with hacked information. But I was actually trying to think of like, okay, New York Tandon is fine with that. Like these people love that. They don't care about the double standards. And they, so, but if this standard were ever applied fairly, I mean, wouldn't the Trump tax things have to be, wouldn't they be dubiously sourced?
Yeah, and you, there's a whole universe of stories that would have to be blocked.
Yeah, which are anti-Trump stories.
Anti-Trump stories or you know, pro-Assange stories or, you know, anything involving WikiLeaks, like those kinds of leaks that come out all the time. Think about the FinCEN file stories, the money laundering stories. Like those were sort of, you know, the provenance of all those financial documents is probably would have triggered some of these policies. So... I'm just trying
to reach out to the wino moms and the New York Tandons out there who couldn't care less about WikiLeaks, but to show them that if this look, I mean, they're probably being rational actors about this because they're like, yeah, well, we're in tight with these people and they're not going to ever ban, you know, prevent people from sharing links about Trump's taxes.
Oh, well, that's a cool, of course, that's what they think. Yeah.
Yeah. It's just a bad look. And it's so overtly not consistent with how they treat other things. I mean, it's not even close. Like, they don't do this with other links.
No, and this is like a classic third world thing where you have one set of rules that's written and then there's another set of rules that's unwritten and everybody knows what the real reason, you know, for a thing being banned is. That's a bad situation when you have like kind of two different realities that you're weighing constantly. Like,
yeah. And then being attacked for sharing it because you're somehow working for the Russians is like, I don't even know.
That's a bonus.
A bonus. Okay. Yeah. So for Republicans suck, we have U.S. threatened sanctions after U.N. embargo against Iran expires. So Secretary of State Mike Pompeo warned Sunday that the United States will slap sanctions on any individual or entity that assists Iran's weapons program, a move that will likely intensify tensions between Washington and Tehran. Last month, the United States unilaterally reimposed UN sanctions on Tehran through a snapback process, and tensions between Washington and Tehran have mounted after Trump's withdrawal from the landmark Iran nuclear agreement in 2018, calling it the worst deal ever.
Hmm.
So that's bad.
Yeah.
Again, it's so funny. Like if the Dems actually ever paid attention to anything besides Russia, they'd maybe talk about this because, again, this arm, you know, this deal was worked out by Barack Obama. They talk about it a teeny bit, but not that much. And it's certainly disproportionate. And I bring it up for a couple of reasons. One, to remind people that Pompeo is a born again evangelical. And, two, because I feel like I have to speak out on behalf of very handsome killed man, Soleimani.
I knew that's where this was going.
Yeah. I mean, look, I gotta speak. He's not around anymore, Matt.
I understand that, yeah.
Who will speak for Soleimani?
That's right.
That should be our tagline for this show. Useful idiots speaking for Soleimani.
That's right. The voice for the voiceless.
Yes.
And dead.
Dead and voiceless. And, you know, people who often online will try to make this dubious connection between my acknowledging his handsomeness and my principal defense of necrophilia. And there's nothing there because I don't like necrophilia personally. I just question the way we talk about it morally. And
haven't thought about it theoretically.
No, it really does disgust me. I don't mean to alienate the necrophilia block that I'm sure watches the show religiously, because there's a great likelihood that it will come up. I'm going to lose their support. I think it's disgusting, but it's not my cup of tea. But again, going back to my principle, as long as the necrophiliac is not religious.
Right. Yeah. As long as it's just to you, a dead piece of meat.
Yes. Well, actually, I think this got cut. I wonder why, because we're speaking truth to power. But I did make the point, I think you agree with me, Matt, that the ideal victim of, well, I'm not even going to say victim, the ideal subject of necrophilia is a hermit with no living relatives.
Right,
so then that there's absolutely no moral question. Yeah,
there's no moral question because there's nobody who would be like freaked out by it.
Right,
except on general like humane principles.
Right. Yeah, but they have no. But they are they.
There's no personal stake in it.
Yeah, exactly. No skin in the game. Yeah.
Right.
I don't even know where the pun is there, but it sounds like something.
No sloughing off skin in the game.
But yeah, the Iran stuff isn't good. Anything that, like, you know, ratchets up tensions with any other country basically is bad, I would say. That's my hot take. It's never a good idea. Sanctions are never a good idea. And you know what they do is they actually really stir anti-American sentiment, and they strengthen the ideological legitimacy of governments. Because all governments, I mean, it's very useful to point to that. It creates a bunker mentality. It's a great distraction from the ways that governments are failing their people. They get to point to that. And obviously, I don't think Pompeo cares about the suffering. I mean, sanctions really lead to suffering, and they are their economic warfare that results in death. Like, they are fatal. Mm-hmm. They're ineffective. And obviously, Pompeo doesn't care about that. But what I do think is interesting is that it does create more legitimacy for the government that's targeted.
That's right. That's right. Well, it's an ugly story, but it's probably not going to get in the news because we're 2 weeks off from the election. And all right. So for isn't that terrible? I just want to get through this one quick because we got to talk about the important issue of the day. So
yeah, we can't let that shrink away from us.
Right. We can't let that shrivel. So just really quickly, Scientific American did a story that's kind of like the isn't that terrible of isn't that terrible. It's like a compilation of all the bad things that happened in 2020, like a running list of all the awfulness. Dan, if we could see that story. Actually, this has been like a record-setting bad year in like many different ways. One of the first things they pointed out is that this is only the second time in history that the official alphabetical list of hurricane names has been exhausted.
Right.
They've had to move to the supplementary list of Greek letter names, which I think we're on already, right? We're on Epsilon now. Is that what's coming?
It's almost like Muskian, Elon Muskian.
Right. They went, and so there's a whole bunch of stuff about how this, we've had more storms this year and earlier this year than we've ever had big storms. Then they went down to wildfires and horrific numbers, 4 million acres across California. This breaks all the previous records of the amount of territory that's been destroyed. And then there was an entry about rain and flooding. And if we could see this, and it said heavy rain sent water levels in the Tittabawassee River to record highs in May.
And where is that river located?
Well, it's funny that you asked that, Katie, because I had to look that up. And Dan, if we could get the tape for how do we pronounce Tittabawassee?
We are looking at how to pronounce Tittabawassee. 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 Tittabawassee.
What's weird is that, like, you just have to say Tittabawassee. Tittabawassee. It's on the wa. That's the emphasis. Where is it?
In Michigan, right? I think. Yes.
It's in this country? Yes, in the U.S. of A?
Yes.
What's the origin of it? Like, what language is it?
It's probably, I'm guessing, a Native American language.
Right. You know who we should ask about that to have on as an expert? It's
Is Elizabeth Warren?
Elizabeth Warren, yeah.
Yeah, absolutely, we should. And if there's any of the 10,000 residents from the Tittabawassee.
Tittabawassee. They just are going up and down in their cadence. It's
like the water levels.
Oh, I see. Yeah, you're right.
Tittabawassee. So that happened, and that was bad. And so that was, isn't that terrible? Tittabawassee.
Anyway, so for isn't that weird, this is a both isn't that weird and also isn't that validating. So I got a message from a fan of the show who actually lives in Beirut. A fan of the show messaged me, and I just want to tell you, should I tell you what he said, or should we just watch this?
You can tell me what he said.
All right. I was listening to your latest podcast with the snake and the toilet incident in Thailand and thought I'd share a close call I had with a less dangerous reptile. Okay, then I'll read the next two messages after we watch the videotape.
That's a lizard in the toilet. Check this out.
Oh, no, that's terrible.
Yeah, I think so too.
He's like struggling.
Oh, the last time I flushed it, he came back out. I'm afraid to go to the bathroom. Who knows what else is going to come out of here?
So for people who are just listening to the show, we see a little lizard in a toilet bowl, and then it is flushed cruelly, I would say, cruelly flushed down the toilet when you could have easily just reached in there.
I would say coldly.
Coldly, yeah, you're right. There's not, it's not sadistic. It's just callous.
It's just callously. Yeah, I think that's probably better.
All right, so let's watch the next video from the same person, and this is from the day after.
He came back.
This fucking thing is back.
Look at that tail.
Die.
It's a long tail.
Oh my god.
Dude, take it out.
And now, as people can't see, but it's...
He's hanging on for dear life.
Or is there a whole fucking family of these things living inside?
I want to say something, in full disclosure, to be transparent. Mm-hmm. I edited the second video.
I didn't edit it,
it cut out the end. Because if I hadn't, I think it technically would have been a snuff film.
Really?
Because he flushes again, and then it doesn't come back.
Well, that you flushed and didn't immediately come back the first time.
You're right. But if I ended on that note, it would look like I was condoning it. And it would have been very sad. I'm already sad that it happened. I really thought I was going to have a happy ending. I'm hoping it comes back the next day.
Right.
But I can't. And I told him that I was very disappointed. And he said he is, you know, he feared for his life. And so he was. I said, oh, my God, you have to save him. And he goes, it's a bit late now. After the second day, he didn't return. I said, you committed lizardcide. And he goes, not sure. He survived a couple of times. He's obviously a good swimmer. I don't even know if it was the same one, where he just admitted possible manslaughter. Because it could have been another one. And then I told him, I'm only going to show the video up until the part where he returns, rises like a phoenix. And then the friend says, and anyway, he invaded my inner sanctum. It was him or me. I had to stand my ground. For all I know, he could have grown up to be an alligator. He posed a clear and present danger to my
nether. That's the standard. Regions. Yeah.
I thought it was the gecko lizard.
I mean, you could have just taken the lizard out and let it go.
Yeah, that's the nice thing to do. Right. And, you know, he's trying to use the stand your ground thing. And you know what's so messed up about that is that if you're a lizard and see how that goes.
Right. It doesn't really work that way. Right. He's got anti-lizard privilege.
And it shows how embedded the privilege is that he thought it would be acceptable to film that. Because
he knows
he'll get away with it.
He knows that there are men around the world who will think that is funny.
Right. I knew you'd think it was funny.
You're
one of those men around the world, Matt.
Right.
Got one right here.
I'm actually not anti-lizard. I would have taken the lizard out. You would have, right?
But a caterpillar, you would have taken the caterpillar.
Caterpillar, I would have flushed.
Blended. No, you would have put it in a blender.
I would have put it in a blender. That's true. All right. Well, that's the four food groups. Now we get to the actual meat and potatoes of the show. Yeah. All right. How do we even introduce this?
How do we unzip this story?
So everybody knows we're talking about Jeffrey Toobin's Zoom video. And if you don't know Jeffrey Toobin, what's your first memory of Jeffrey Toobin, Katie?
I don't know. I feel like he's always been there. I honestly don't know what my first memory is of him. What's yours?
So for me, he kind of came into my life during the OJ trial because he was the big legal expert. He wrote a book called The Run of His Life that I actually had with me for years and years and years overseas. It wasn't a bad book, actually. You know, he's a former prosecutor. So he's become, over the years, he's kind of morphed into this very central figure in the New Yorker hierarchy. He was pretty commonly a commentator on the Russiagate stuff for the New Yorker. And just kind of an overall kind of hashtag resistance, you know, central casting character. So I guess they were having group Zoom, like an election simulation.
They were LARPing
like a contested election scenario.
Like So Masha Gessen was like Donald Trump. Who else were the characters? There was like someone playing establishment Dems, someone playing like Bernie-crats, and Toobin was representing the Supreme Court.
Right, he was the judge, and so at some point.
They took a break. They took a break between, I guess, role play scenes or something, between LARPing. They took a 10-minute break. And at this point, the first article about it made it just look like he had his penis hanging out. But then it was revealed that he was actually, I guess, kind of engaging it.
He was flogging it, right?
He was masturbating, yeah. He was masturbating. In fact, that guy, what's his name, who I love? The freedom fighter who has the penis sculpture?
Oh, the guy.
Uh-huh. Yeah, who we have to have on. I finally found him on Twitter. He should do he should erect a Zoomin Toobin statue.
So what, he comes back from the break and his story is that he thinks he's muted?
He says he thought he muted the video.
And so he sits down and
he's already sitting down. And
was he completely in flagrante or what?
He they take the break. He's sitting down, and then all of a sudden, I think the camera had been like facing his face, and then it flips. It moves down to his crotch, and he gets to work. And his excuse was that he thought that he didn't know people could see him.
So okay, there's a couple of things going on here. I have never had an erotic thought during a Zoom call.
Maybe you just haven't had the right Zoom call.
But I mean, what possible excuse could you have for in the middle of an election simulation? Like, how would that thought get into your head unless you had something going on?
A Ginsburg fetish.
A Ginsburg fetish?
Yeah. I mean, keep planking. Very suggestive. That became the motto of the resistance around her. What else? Maybe what was the movie that Clarence Thomas apparently kept bringing up? Long Dong Silver?
Oh, Long Dong Silver, yeah.
Maybe that was it. There's so many things. I mean, the gavel is very suggestive. We got actually a lot of like interesting, like kind of sexual identity, like actually a lot of questioning of heteronormativity, I would say. You got John Roberts, who played Peppermint Patty in a play when he was younger. That's a character from what, Snoopy? And it's a woman.
Peanuts, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Peanuts, yeah. You have, the late Rehnquist, who is very into musical theater, added stripes to his shoulders, stripes to the robe, because he was inspired by a fairy judge character in Iolanthe. None of this is planned, by the way. I didn't come into this story. I'm just like spitballing here.
Yeah, but, absolutely.
I just think, what would make you do that? I mean, okay. What do you think happened? I know I have my theory on what happened.
See, that's the problem that I have is that I can't get myself into the mental frame of mind where I can imagine that happening.
Now you know how I feel when you asked me about how many caterpillars could fit in a blender. But I think what happened was that he took a break. There was a break from their reenactment. I mean, it could be a performative, satirical criticism of the Supreme Court, but I'm going to say that's not what it was.
I think it's got to be an anger thing toward his workplace, don't you think?
Well, I just think maybe he's really into porn. Yeah. Wish I could unsee that. I just think he's really into porn, or into porn. I don't want to say really. He had a break. He felt. I don't know why. You know, maybe he'd started doing this before and he was interrupted. He wanted to get back to it. Seems like a fairly diligent guy. Maybe, he likes to finish what he starts. And then he lowered, I think he probably had porn on another screen.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And he got confused and was watching, or he had the porn on this thing. That's probably what it was. He probably had porn open on his laptop, right? This is just one theory. He had porn open on his laptop. And again, by the way, this is as this is as not relatable to me as necrophilia is. So what you got to wait for. So it's not like, oh, I get it. I've done this. Like during, actually, you guys have to rewatch all the episodes of Useful Idiots and try to figure out which ones I was.
Which
doing
ones you
during.
Were watching
yeah.
porn during?
Yeah, yeah.
And what porn it was?
Yeah, what porn? What genre? Yeah. No. Well, we know we watch porn publicly when we watch that Mark Levin and Charlie Kirk porn.
That's right. Yeah. Yeah, it moved. Yeah.
Ooh, you're smart, Aristotle. So
swing.
Actually, you wouldn't know even if you had a full body shot because, well, okay, I'm a woman, but the reason you don't know with Matt is because he has the helpful the erection obfuscation clipboard. In fact, if Jeffrey Toobin had watched this show, he would have known to always have a boner obfuscating Clipboard,
right. Yes.
So Jeffrey Toobin, this is your, I was about to defend you, and I will defend you in a couple of seconds, but I am saying to some extent, this could have been avoided if you watched this great show. Okay. So back to what I think happened. I think he had the porn opened. He has a break. He's like, wants to, you know, jerk off. And he thinks that when you mute, because, you know, on Zoom, there's a camera and then there's a microphone. Even the way he said he muted the camera, I think he doesn't understand that. And this is why I'm giving him the ageism. Is his angle should be ageism, that this is an ageist attack because he's not very Zoom savvy.
I mean, this is like a 3-year-old who thinks that if you put a bucket over your head that they can't see you.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Yeah. So he presses the mute thing and doesn't press the camera off thing. Now, some people think it was like intentional, like he wanted to do it in front of, like it was a thrill or an exhibitionist thing. I don't think that that's really, the evidence is there for that. It could be that, that could be the case.
Who could want that? I mean, he's for the rest of his life, this is going to follow him around. I mean, actually, this is an interesting philosophical question. What would Jeffrey Toobin have to do for this to not be in the first line of his obituary?
I mean, I think he needs to call out this culture, this kink shaming in a way. It's not kink shaming. It's moral. Here's the thing. I actually don't know if there's anything wrong with, they're two very different things. If you are intentionally masturbating and watching people on the screen with whom you're having a meeting, I mean, there is the whole, if a tree falls and no one hears it, doesn't make a sound.
You're right. There is an interesting philosophical question.
There is, right? But you are, I think that's a violation. No one may know about it, but I do think it's a violation because you are, people don't know that you are pleasuring yourself to their image. Now, it's not like the alternative, excuse me, I'm going to, do you have your consent to pleasure myself to your image? That's not going to work either.
Right.
So you're kind of screwed. But I think there's a big difference between that and accidentally exposing yourself while masturbating.
That's a good thing that you brought that up, because noted media critic Brian Stelter came to Jeffrey Toobin's defense. And Dan, if we could see that.
He came to? Sorry. What does it say? What's the headline, though? CNN's Brian Stelter ripped over tweet about Jeffrey Toobin. They really tore him a new one.
Yes. So he tweeted, Jeffrey Toobin has been sidelined at a pivotal moment in the run-up to the presidential election. The reason he exposed himself during a Zoom call with New Yorker colleagues in what he says was an accident. And obviously people got upset because you don't accidentally whack it. Like,
I don't know. I'm going to push back on this. I think I'm with Stelter on this.
Really?
Yeah.
I mean, it was accidentally disclosed, but you're not accidentally jacking off.
No, you're accidentally doing it visibly, though.
Okay. Yeah, that's two different things, though.
Right.
Yes.
And I do think, look, the fact that it was during a break is pivotal to me. Now, if he was, again, there's a moral difference. We have to look at the mens rea here. There's a moral difference between jerking off while watching. Now, also, I don't want to be presumptuous. Maybe he doesn't do it to porn. Maybe he just does it to whatever, for all I know. We don't know. But I do really think that there's a difference between doing it intentionally, watching the people on the screen who don't know that you're watching them.
Mm-hmm.
And just accidentally leaving your camera on.
Right.
Because also, if he put the camera to his crotch, he can't see them.
That's true.
Yep. So it could be exhibitionism, but I don't think that's true. I don't think he wanted them to see it. So the more I think about this, the more moral clarity I'm getting about it. And I think he almost did nothing wrong.
He almost did.
His mistake was not shutting off his camera.
Yeah, the morality here is separate from the internet consequences. I mean, this is, you know, what's the line? Somebody's famous on Twitter every day, and the goal of everyone is not to be that person.
Right.
Right. And he's going to be that person for the next 6 years. Toobin is going to become a word.
Yeah, Zoom and Toobin. I really think that I disagree with you, Matt, because I the world I want to live in is a world where we look at the. We don't just look at the outcome. We don't just look at what happened. We look at the mitigating circumstances. We look at the context. And that's why if you kill someone accidentally, it's manslaughter. And if you plan it, it's murder. And I don't think he committed masturbatory murder. I think maybe masturbatory manslaughter, if we're just using that equivalent.
The last thing I will say about this is that I think clearly Jeffrey Toobin right now probably feels like he'd like to put himself on a rocket and shoot himself into space and never come back. But the only way to handle a situation like this is to go completely the other way and to embrace your new identity as the person who jacked off on the internet.
Right. You open the door. I mean, this is a game-changing moment. You may change the way. I think people are going to be forced to come down on one side or the other of this issue.
He needs to get himself a deal for a reality show.
Yeah.
He needs to start a political career. You know what I mean?
I agree.
And base everything on his newfound internet celebrity.
Right. Like, I agree.
You know what I'm saying?
Like, Push back on the shaming. Why should he be shamed for it?
Right,
again,
exactly.
It's a combination of ageism and heteronormativity and kink shaming.
Right. Yes. Yeah, I did something stupid. Yeah, I did it. But by the way, vote for me for president. Like, that's the way he should be. That's the way to handle that.
Yeah, maybe, you know what? Maybe he couldn't concentrate. Maybe he had to in order to participate meaningfully in this role play. Maybe he needed to finish what he started.
Yeah. I don't think he did. I think he just wanted to. I think he was just. Well, I don't know. He's going to have to explain at some point. But
Jeffrey, please come on the show. Look, this is a big deal. Matt Taibbi, I'm sure you disagree with him on Russiagate stuff. But if you want to clear your name, there's one show and one show only where you can do that. I've done wonderful work, like destigmatizing necrophilia. I'm a major civil rights, civil libertarian when it comes to penis art, and I think I could do wonders for you. And
put on a tie and nothing else, and turn on that Zoom, and we'll talk. All right, before we run out of time, quickly, and we're going to be talking to pollster Ben Tulchin. We got to talk about one thing quickly. This magazine, Rolling Stone, came out with an endorsement of Joe Biden this week. And Dan, if we could see the graphic.
Yeah, so we're looking at the cover. It says Biden's moment: why he is the right leader to rebuild America. He's, what would you say? He's 3/4 profile.
Yeah, he's kind of looking up with satisfaction at some fixed object in the sky.
Yeah,
all right.
He's slightly above eye level. His gaze is slightly above eye level. I don't know if it's satisfaction. You think it's satisfaction? I feel like it's like
steely determination, maybe
something like that. Yeah.
Yeah.
There's a blue sky with clouds, like light. You know, not ominous. There's no portending of rain or anything.
So you know, Rolling Stone did this, and look. I get it. I'm probably going to vote for Joe Biden myself, and I think there's clearly a way that you can endorse him. But they wrote it a certain way, as where they not only said, "Okay, well, we gotta vote for this guy because we don't have a choice." They actually sort of wrote it as if it was a really good idea, and they wrote this thing. Here's a couple of lines that I thought you might be interested in, Katie. Think of it as a coalition of the decent, ranging from Bernie Sanders, Barbara Lee, and Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez on the left to Never Trumpers, John Kasich, Cindy McCain, and Bill Kristol on the right. So that's who we're voting.
All right. So there's no one on decent that they listed on the right, first of all.
Right.
Like there's no decency there.
And they concluded by saying, this is a fight between light and darkness. Rolling Stone is proud to stand in the light and endorse Joe Biden for president. Vote like your country and perhaps even your life depends on it. Look, I think my two cents on this is the way you do this editorial is just to say, look, he's running against Donald Trump. You got to vote for him.
Right.
So we, Rolling Stone, are going to, like a hunchback abusing himself in the alley, are going to go do our duty and just pull the lever for this guy. And we think you should do that too, because that's really the only rational choice right here. You know, this whole pretending that Joe Biden is a great dude and a terrific choice. I just don't know about that. I don't think I would have written it that way necessarily.
Yeah. I mean, I've had a few guests on the show. I'm looking for this Michael Moore quote where he says he'll vote for Biden, but he won't lie for him. also, I had a friend of this show, Adolf Reed, on the show, who said that, you know, the way he saw his motto for why people should vote for Biden was Biden-Harris, because sometimes you got to just clean the damn toilet. So he's not fans of either of theirs, but he just thinks that, I guess, using that metaphor, Trump is like, you know, more of a stool, I guess. I don't know. Like,
right. That would have been my cover. It would have been just, you know, roll, like, you look at the big shit sandwich.
Yeah, exactly. Right?
And like America taking a bite. You know what I mean?
Oh, well, Nina Turner said, like, it's like one bowl of eating one bowl of shit versus two bowls of shit. That's right. How she compared Trump and Biden.
Biden Harris 2020, one bowl of shit.
One scoop.
Yeah, exactly. What's wrong with that?
And Marianne Williamson, by the way, on my show told me, vote blue like your life depended on it, because it just might. So that, I think those things are much more honest than, or I think another thing to embrace is vote for the neo, because neoliberalism is easier to organize under than neo-fascism. That's another argument that Cornel West makes, for instance.
Doesn't fit on a bumper sticker.
It's not a good bumper sticker. But anyone who already likes Biden, you know, loves him or pretends to love him, anyone who's on the fence about him reads this and it's like, it's not convincing at all. No, mm-hmm. You don't win any converts, because it just looks like you're selling, you know, a bill of what? What's the expression?
Goods, I think.
Yeah, I mean, you're just selling a shit sandwich and pretending it's a BLT. It is annoying, I have to admit, because it's like, there's so many annoying people on both sides of this. There are the obviously annoying, like, people who always hate people like me, who are just like, Biden is the best, and how dare you? There's a lot of privilege, discourse about privilege. How dare you? Why are you helping Trump? And then on the other side, though, when I've made the argument that Trump is worse than Biden, I get the, like, you neoliberal shill, MSNBC. Mm. Just, like, vote for whomever you want, I guess, except I think that in swing states. Well, what do you think about, like, do you think that it's important to vote? Well, you said you're probably going to vote Biden. If you don't vote Biden, what would you do?
Not vote.
Right in Crazy Crab?
I would think about somebody like Crazy Crab. I mean, didn't Hunter Thompson in 1968... famously said he voted for Dick Gregory, the comedian. You know, this is one of those kind of like unappealing choice years.
I mean, I think what it is a harm reduction argument. And this is not a harm reduction argument. This is glowing, pretending to be super progressive.
A turd, like, you know, heroically like a portrait of that looking off in the distance, like backlit. You know?
Yes, you're right. And you know what they could have had? They could have
had an open collar.
Yeah, a turd and open collar. And then also they should have had a turd and open collar fighting face to face with a huge
turd.
Huge turd. Yeah. And like then you do the David and Goliath thing. Yeah, that's really the optics you need. In fact, Rolling Stone, if you want to talk to me or Matt, we're open to it. Yep. We have some really good ideas about how you can actually win people over for Biden.
Well, next time they'll know to talk to us. That's all. I think that's the long and the short of it. All right. So we're going to talk to Ben Tulchin, who's going to give us the lowdown on what we should expect on election night and how we should read the results and what to look for, what not to look for, things to worry about in terms of the accuracy of the polls. It should be a really interesting conversation and looking forward to it.
Yeah.
So welcome, Ben Tulchin, to Useful Idiots.
Thanks for having me.
So you have been a high-level pollster for a long time. You worked, obviously, you were Bernie Sanders' pollster in 2016 and in this election cycle as well, but also worked, I think, with Howard Dean once upon a time, Gray Davis, and a lot of other politicians. And you spoke recently with the New York Times about Joe Biden and how he might do better this time than Hillary Clinton did last time with some voters. Can you tell us a little bit about what your perception of that is and why he might be gaining votes that Hillary didn't get?
Yeah, sure. Look, I mean, 2020 is a very different election than 2016. First of all, we've had 4 years of Donald Trump, and he's shown to voters what kind of president he is. And quite frankly, you know, he's fundamentally failed the leadership test, when especially when it comes to COVID. And so voters now have had to assess a body of work on his behalf. over the last 4 years. And so now he's the incumbent. And what happened in 2016 is Hillary Clinton, having been a product of the establishment and having served in Washington for many years, she was seen as the de facto incumbent. So a lot of undecided voters were frustrated with the way things were going, moved against her. That's what kind of brought about Trump's surprise win. But now Trump's on the ballot. He's in the White House. He's the incumbent. And voters are assessing his performance in office, and his job approval has been consistently negative for since he started his term in office. And so he's now the center of attention's on him now, and his job performance as president. So it's very different.
But you've said that Biden specifically, he's tough to hit, right? Was the way you characterized it. I think it obviously going against him in the primary season, what makes him a difficult candidate to assess in terms of like how people are going to respond to him?
Yeah, I mean, he's a likable guy, right? And people are very familiar with him. He was vice president for 8 years, and they're comfortable with him. And we saw that in the primary from working for Bernie. I mean, Biden was consistently in first place, and our job at Bernie was try to supplant him from first place, and we found it very, very difficult. And look, you've seen what's happened in the general election. Trump's had a hard time figuring out a line of attack against Biden and sticking with it. And I think, at the fundamental level, voters kind of like Biden and are comfortable with him and, feel like he's a good guy. And so once you have that, and the fact that he's been, in the public eye for a while, that voters are comfortable with him, it's hard to dislodge that, right, from voters. And so we experienced that in the primary working against him from Bernie's campaign, and you see Trump struggling to really make any real inroads against Biden and a negative attack. And I think that likability carries over. I mean, he's, the Scranton Joe, side of him, I think, comes out in many ways. And he's a hard guy to attack.
And is it, in the last election, Trump did well with voters who were older. He also did well with voters who were ambivalent about both candidates. Does Biden do well with both of those constituencies? I mean, it seems to me that what you're talking about with that inability to dislodge the positive perception of him, that might be more true with older voters than younger voters. But is that going to help him there?
Yeah, I mean, look, if you look at polling nationally and state-by-state basis, I mean, Biden's beating Trump by 10 points with seniors, and that's not a constituency that's all that progressive. It tends to be older, more Caucasian, more conservative. There are two factors, I would say, with seniors. One is Trump's mishandling of the coronavirus. I mean, seniors are most at risk of it, and Trump's literally been putting their lives at risk. So,
right.
So that's one part. But the other is just Biden's demeanor. He's follows proper protocols. I mean, and seniors are comfortable with him. And his moderate politics, quite frankly, make seniors more comfortable with Biden than they would a more progressive Democrat, for example. I mean, the trade-off between Biden and Bernie, for example, had Bernie won the nominees, Bernie inspires young people, but he doesn't do as well with seniors, right? But Biden, now Trump is motivating young people, and Biden has been able to consolidate young people, Latinos and voters he wasn't winning over in the primary because of the Trump fear factor. But the fact that Biden is winning seniors consistently by 10 points over Trump really tells us that in looking at data, I think it's the COVID factor plus they're just the decorum, the fact that they see Biden as experienced and has the ability to do the job. And they're comfortable with him.
Presidential. I of course think that I've always said this, and not just because I liked him, but I always thought Bernie had a potential leg up on Biden in a couple of ways, which is like the corruption stuff or lack thereof, the consistency and like the unapologetic nature of his campaign and his personality. I thought that Biden, when we were watching the debate, I think I said that I thought he won, but while I was watching, I kind of thought he was losing. But I mean, I do think, and I'm curious what the data there is for this, that Bernie, in terms, like one of Trump's biggest strengths is going after people's hypocrisy because he doesn't ever claim to be anything. Like he has no consistency issues and Sanders is so consistent. So that was,
a strength for Bernie?
Yeah.
No, absolutely. I mean, look, Bernie had a lot of strengths, right? He is authenticity. And that's one of those intangible traits in politics that's invaluable and very hard to achieve and obtain. And he also had a very, very clear economic message, right? His sense of, you know, rigged economy propped up by a corrupt political system, taking on the economic status quo, political status quo, or was failing so many people. And obviously with COVID, that's accentuated it beyond belief, right? But the thing with what's happened with COVID is, you know, real people's lives are getting impacted on a daily basis. I mean, all of our lives are, right? I mean, this is, we're doing this by Zoom because we were all working by Zoom these days. And so this election became much more consequential, quite frankly. And then Trump's leadership is now, I mean, this election's evolved into a referendum on his leadership, especially his failure of leadership on COVID. And as a result, you know, Biden is essentially the acceptable alternative to Trump. And so it's less about Biden's, you know, whatever strengths and weaknesses are, he's proving this to be a viable, acceptable alternative to Trump. And quite frankly, if you look at polling and, you know, for Bernie's campaign, we looked at a lot of polling and the general election polling, both Bernie versus Biden. And Biden's lead has been remarkably stable. I mean, there's been ups and downs, but over the last 2 years, he's been consistent, as was Bernie. Bernie and Biden were both leading Trump by 8 to 10 points nationally. And what happened with COVID, it just solidified the race in Biden's favor and the Democrats' favor. So COVID really changed the race in terms of what each candidate had to offer, what the race was about, and what Biden really had to offer to prevail.
There was that, was it Naomi Klein or Kianga Yamada Taylor who wrote that piece that like Bernie won reality and like if it had been delayed a couple of days or weeks, he would have won the primary. Is there anything to that?
Oh man, that's a whole nother show. The primary. The primary, the challenge of the primary was, you know, look, beating a former vice president of the United States is very hard to do, right? And you know, look in the track record of nominations. I mean, the former VP, sitting VP, tends to win pretty handily. And, you know, it was very hard to displace him in the battle, the primary. I mean, what we saw was the battle was Biden was doing very well with older non-college educated voters, white, black, and Latino. Bernie was doing very well with younger voters, especially younger non-college voters, including whites, blacks, and Latinos. And the battleground between Bernie and Biden was basically middle-aged working class voters, white, black, and Latino. And Bernie won Nevada when he lost it 4 years previously. Bernie added Latinos to his progressive coalition and expanded it to his coalition of younger voters, millennials in particular, and independents and left-leaning Democrats. And so Bernie made it a very contested primary, and then ultimately we were unsuccessful in dislodging those middle-aged working-class voters from, because they like Bernie, they like Biden a little bit more, they're a little bit more comfortable with Biden. And so we had, as a campaign, what we had to do was make them feel a little bit less comfortable with Biden and more comfortable with Bernie. And we were able to do that in Nevada, and then you know, we just fell a little bit short, but anyway, that's relitigating the primary, but that's to Biden's strength, right? I mean, the voters just, we saw, they just felt comfortable with him. Right. And it took a lot to get a voter to say, I like Bernie, I like Biden, I'm sticking with Biden. And it took a lot to get them, and we didn't quite get enough to move them over. But what's happened in the general election is that comfort that voters have, including working class voters, is turning into real strength for Biden, right? I mean, that's really what's coming out in the general election, why he's doing well in places like Michigan, Wisconsin, Pennsylvania, that you know, that Trump ended up winning. But that's why Biden's, if you look at the map, right? I mean, Biden's competitive in Ohio and Iowa right now. We lost those states badly 4 years ago. He's, you know, Michigan, Pennsylvania, Wisconsin, he's got a sizable lead there that's reflective of the national lead. So, you know, honestly, his strength with working class voters, including working class white voters, is helping him perform better than Hillary did 4 years ago.
So 2016 has the business of polling been affected a lot by what happened in 2016? I mean, obviously that was a race where, at least in the press, all the prognosticators were completely wrong from the very beginning. They were absolutely certain Trump wasn't going to win the nomination, and then they were certain again that he wasn't going to win the general election. Were there conclusions that had to be drawn about maybe things that were being missed, or is, have there been changes that have been made since then?
Look, I mean, the industry's still recovering from 2016. I mean, all and so are Democrats, quite frankly. I mean, like for 2020, when, you know, there's a lot of good data, the early ballots are really heavily Democratic, the polling's really good, and yet no one wants to go out there and say it's going to be a blue wave because we're all shell-shocked from 2016 and we're, you know, enduring PTSD. But so what's happened from 2016 to now is a pretty significant evolution in the business or in the industry. I mean, what was 2016 was heavily reliant on phone only surveys. Now we do what's called multimodal, which is you're contacting people by email, cell phones, and text messages to their cell phones. So the percent of people we actually call landlines now is diminishing as landlines, disappear essentially. So we're able to reach people through different mediums now. And and for me, what we've seen in our own research, for example, is we do emails, texting, cell phones, and landlines. And we found with emails, we tend to get more middle-aged white Republican leaning men, right? I mean, who, will take time away from their email to respond by email, but we may not be able to get, the criticism like 2016 was there a silent Trump voter that pollsters weren't reaching. We've seen like if you reach people different ways, young people tend to respond to text, for example, seniors will still answer a landline. So now we try to reach people from different mediums and able to get a better cross section of voters. But look, I mean, the national polling had Hillary winning the national vote by 2 points, and that's essentially what it was. So some of the state by state polling, missed the mark. But, the other piece of it was, how badly did I miss the mark? Undecideds tend to break against the incumbent. And then, as I mentioned earlier, like Hillary's seen as the incumbent, both Hillary and Trump were seen as unpopular, right? And so if you have two unpopular candidates running against each other, but you're angry at the status quo, you're going to vote for the change candidate. The difference between 2020 is Biden's his favorables are positive. Like he's now gotten a net positive favorable unfavorable rating. And Trump continues to be unpopular, right? So now if you're undecided voter, you're like, I don't like Trump. I have mixed feelings about Biden. It's a lot easier to break the Biden. Right. And so that's another fundamental difference where you look at what the polling and what happened in 2016, some of it missed the mark, but actually it made sense. Right. It made sense that voters said, OK, I'm reacting against undecided voters who are disproportionately downscale or frustrated with the political status quo, frustrated with the economic status quo, kind of moved against the quote unquote, like being the establishment candidate for the change candidate.
You should hire Ben Jealous because he, I had him on the show the election day. We did the whole interview was like about how to hold Hillary Clinton's feet to the fire when she won. And then at the end of the interview, I jokingly said like, we should tape two endings in case Trump wins. And he's like, fear the possibility that Trump wins. And then he's like, there's cicada voters. Like they don't get polled because if you don't vote a certain number in the last cycle, you won't get polled. And there are two things that bring those people out. And that is extremism and celebrity, and Trump has both of them. And the unlikely voters, people think of them as Black or Latino, but there's also unlikely white. It was like, oh, and it was basically exactly what happened.
Yeah, so Ben and I worked together closely on the Bernie's 2016 campaign. He's very talented and bright guy. And look, I mean, those of us who worked for Bernie in 2016, not to say that we predicted Trump's win, but we saw the anger and frustration and that a large segment of the electorate had, that they were frustrated with the economic status quo, frustrated with them. Why was Bernie so successful in 2016? He tapped into something, right? He tapped into a lot of people who were frustrated economically, frustrated from politics as usual. And unfortunately, 4 years later, there are even more people who are facing economic and financial despair and seeing our government, federal government fail so miserably. So it's only, exponentially worse now, but it's more obvious, right? So it wasn't under the surface like it was in 2016. And like, that's part of the establishment. I mean, the problem with the Beltway, right, is it's a upper middle class, comfortable, cocoon. It's a bubble, and it really struggles with the media and politicians ensconced in the Beltway really struggle to kind of connect with the rest of America, and there are times to pay a price for it.
And then it seemed like that is a positive, like Bernie's, someone's ability to tap into people and like bring them out to another side, right? Like, you're angry, I get it, but don't blame Muslims and Mexicans, you know, blame greed, right? As opposed to the, like, your basket of deplorables. But I think that these out of touch, like, people who just talk to each other and have, like, you know, the same dinner party circuit or whatever, they saw that as a negative because they didn't understand that. And they had contempt for, I think, Sanders' ability to speak to those people.
Yeah, look, I mean, it's one of the challenges that we face as a Democratic Party. Our coalition is largely upper middle class, Caucasian, liberals, right? And with our working class voter is Latino and African-American, with a declining share of white working class, like labor union members. As the labor, you know, share of the labor union workforce declines, the Democratic Party's support among white non-college voters has declined over the last, you know, few decades. So if you look at that coalition, and it obviously depends on the state, always the limitation that Bernie had, where he had his progressive populist economic message speaking to a party which, you know, a majority is college educated and has done okay in the rigged economy, right? So they, you know, lefties who've grown up and become, you know, upper middle class are like, I like Bernie, but I'm more comfortable with Elizabeth Warren or Joe Biden or Hillary Clinton, whoever the more establishment friendly candidate is. So that's why but Bernie took it to unprecedented heights. I mean, getting 46% of the pledge in 2016 and emerging as a real contender in 2020, that and Warren's message is similar, like a progressive populist economic message. There's clearly enough potential for that message into our party, but it's challenging because of our coalition and who the party is made up of. So, you know, it's hard to criticize a rigged system when a good chunk of your voters have benefited from, the economy as it is. So that's an internal conflict. But look, I mean, Obama ran as a populist in 2012, remember? I mean, against Mitt Romney, but, you know, he gave his, in the Warren Buffett rule, and he railed against wealthy special interests. So, populism doesn't have an ideology. It's not left or right wing. It's how you channel it. And to your point, it's like, you know, you can either target, the bad guys as immigrants or what have you, or you say, hey, Wall Street banks and greedy corporate special interests are the bad guy. Let's channel this anger from a progressive standpoint, from a left wing standpoint. So that's populism, and obviously Trump mastered that in 2016 to win. Still a lot of anger and frustration, but the good news is Democrats are motivated enough with enough anger towards Trump that they're showing up to vote him out of office now. I mean, that Biden isn't in a populist, and he isn't pretending to be one, but he just needs to be the acceptable alternative to Trump to let that anger flow somewhere.
So in terms of what happens on election night, is there a route to victory that actually still exists for Trump, and what should we be looking for on that night? Like, for instance, if he doesn't win Florida, he's not going to win, basically, right? I mean, are there things that we can know right away as the returns come in? If Biden wins Texas, for instance, is it over at that point? Like, what are some indicators that you're looking for?
Yeah, I mean, so think about the time zone, right? If you're watching it, New Hampshire was very close last time, and that was kind of an early sign that, oh gosh, you know, it was close, right? It was very much closer than any of us anticipated. North Carolina, Florida, neck and neck. So Trump has to win both of those. So if one of them, Biden has a lead, and what's going to be fascinating election night is, Democrats are banking all these early votes. So normally we're behind and play catch up, right? But now we're going to have a lead. And the big thing to watch is election day vote comes in. How Republican is it, right? I mean, there's rumblings of this red tide. There's this big blue tide, blue wave coming in, and it's the red tide can follow. And that's really to see. So the problem is, Matt, is we're going to have to wait a long time because you're going to start with a big lead and then it's going to close. And then we're all going to be, you know, biting our fingernails. But look, I mean, I've done a lot, analyzed the early vote that's in so far in all these swing states, and it's very encouraging. I mean, just and it's not just the most likely voters are voting. I mean, I'm working in Arizona, you know, a huge swing state, right, on a presidential Senate race. And I'm looking at the early returns, and they're heavily Democratic, which is unprecedented. But we're 25% of the Democratic vote that's in are either newly registered or people have no vote history, right? So these are not high propensity voters. So we're getting a decent mix of newer, younger, more progressive, you know, voters who've never voted before, who haven't voted or infrequently. So, but the thing to look at, so it's, you know, North Carolina and Florida on the East Coast, or New Hampshire, those three states. And then, you know, as you move to central time zone, Iowa, and Ohio's East Coast too, right? So Ohio is, I mean, you know, it's very competitive. Trump's struggling with money right now, so he's paring back his advertising. And Ohio wasn't a state that the Biden campaign, from what I understand, was prioritizing, but now it's in play. But North Carolina, Florida are the two states that we lost in 2016, where Biden has a slight lead based on recent polling, and we should have a decent lead on the early vote, and then the election day vote as it comes in will help determine it. But those are the two key states I'd watch for, followed by, you know, Ohio, also East Coast, and then Iowa in the Midwest. Texas is a bonus state. I mean, polling shows us close, Biden slightly behind, but that's a true wave if we win Texas. But it's really, I'd say North Carolina and Florida, and then you have a Senate race in North Carolina too. So that's also an indicator of how whether Democrats can win back the Senate. Because in Iowa and North Carolina have the two big Senate races. Georgia's also very, very close. It's further down in terms of likelihood to win, but all the polling shows it's very, very close, dead even. And you have two Senate races there, but one may be determined on election night. So I put Georgia, but again, if you look at where money has gone and resources and focus of both candidates, North Carolina and Florida are top two.
How does COVID affect the way you can predict the outcome? In other words, we don't have a lot of data on how people are going to behave on election days during a pandemic. So is it difficult to predict, or is it more difficult to predict than it would be in a normal situation?
Yeah, sorry. It's radically changing voter behavior. We have some data, for example, in California, there was a special congressional election, the 25th congressional district, in March of this year. And it was as COVID cases were rising, right? And typically Democrats, Republicans, old white voters, Republicans vote heavily by mail early. And we rely on the election day vote with younger Latinos and more progressive voters. And we make up the difference. To win, we have to make up the difference on election day. It flipped. We won the early vote, but lost the election day vote by 2-1. To this point of Democrats were scared to show up in person. Republicans were like, I'll show up in person without a mask, I don't care. And it had a pretty dramatic impact. And you remember Trump has been trashing voting by mail, right? So, and so what's happened is this early vote that's come in is heavily Democratic. He's basically suppressing his own base vote from voting by mail. So now the Republicans have to do what Democrats normally do, which is right, rely on a very big election day. And that's why I'm pretty bullish on this election, because we're banking votes even among less likely voters. And you're going to have a campaign where the polling has been pretty steady. Biden's been winning by, you know, 8 to 10 points pretty consistently. And, you know, you're going to have a pretty negative losing narrative, negative drumbeat losing narrative around the Trump campaign. Even Republicans starting to trash him now. And that's hard to motivate your vote, your base vote on election day when there's all this talk of him losing. Right. Now, look, some could rear up and say, I'm not giving up on him. But you know, even if you have a margin of 5 or 10% of depression in the Republican base vote, that has huge impact, given because our vote's already in and banked. So look, it's absolutely changing. I mean, you look at the how many ballots are in, it's unprecedented. I mean, it's already motivating. Our side, Democrats were already motivated to begin with. But with the COVID and pandemic and early and voting by mail, we can now channel that energy and actually turn ballots in, whereas before you'd have to sit around and wait till election day to do it. So it's already changing behavior. But what's going to happen is election day typically is neck and neck, or we have a slight advantage on election day after losing the early vote. Now we're going to have a big advantage on the early vote, and the Republicans are going to see how many Republicans show up on election day. So it's radically different and unlike anything we've ever seen before.
And how many, what would the turnout have to look like for it to eclipse your, erode your win, like erode your advantage? In other words, like if there are a bunch of Republicans who don't believe in, you know, if a bunch of Dems stay home because they believe in that COVID's real, and then you have a bunch of Republicans, the ones who are coming out, right, would be maybe the ones who are the most skeptical of it. How many of those people would have to come out for it to be?
It all depends on how many votes we get in the beginning, right? So that's the irony of but we are banking so many votes right now. We have this huge lead nationally and in pretty much every swing state that it's just uncharted waters. We've never ever been. We're always coming from behind, right? And so now we have this lead, and then it's completely dependent on. Election day turnout among Republicans. Obviously, there's a slice of our vote that has to show up and vote on election day, of course. But what's typically happening, if you look at who's voting, like younger voters, Latinos are lagging right now in turnout, but they typically do lag a little bit. Like California, I do a lot of work out here. That's typically the case. It takes a lot of GOTV and pushing them to get them out to vote. Current trajectory though is we'll have a big lead in election. The early returns get reported like at 8:01, right? And then the election day vote rolls in, and so it's going to be a very interesting and a long election night, is my guess.
And last question for me: is it unprofessional to ask you to take a guess on the electoral votes? Do you have a ballpark idea where it's going to end up being?
I mean, I haven't done the electoral college calculation, but I do think my view is I correctly predicted the wave of 2014, which was a bad wave against us. I was one of the few pollsters early on who said, "I don't feel good about where we are." This is like mid-September. And, I adjusted my turnout scenario to make it more conservative. And I do work for the DCCC, Democratic Congressional Campaign Committee. Congressional election, that was a terrible year in 2014. And they, at the end of the cycle, they analyzed the 10 pollsters they hired. And they said I was the most accurate, because when I said a race was going to be close, it was close. And a lot of pollsters had close races that we got blown out and lost by 10 points. And that's what happens in a wave. And I just feel... and based on data that's in, that we have this big lead, unprecedented lead on the early vote. A lot of votes, including low propensity voters, are voting. Our side's highly motivated. And so I think that things tend to break, right? These elections tend to break. Now, look, barring like what happens on the debate Thursday night, but opinions about Trump are fairly well formed at this point. And I can't imagine he's going to turn anything around dramatically on Thursday or the final 10 days. And opinions about Biden are pretty locked in. So I feel pretty comfortable with I think Biden wins by a decent margin nationally. He's got about a 10 point lead. I wouldn't be surprised if he won by, 10 points nationally. And then if he does, then states that I've talked about, like North Carolina, Florida, Iowa, Ohio, tough. I mean, they'll get a lot of those states to break our way, right? So he ends up with a relative landslide. So that's what I would bet on if I were a betting person. I'd bet on a larger margin, both on the a national vote and then the electoral college, because they'll follow. But the caveat is like Georgia, Iowa. There's voter suppression and challenges with voting access. I worked in Georgia last cycle, and their voter registrar threw out 10,000 ballots because it didn't have exact match. And I had a client who ran for Congress who lost by 250 votes, right? I mean, and Stacey Abrams lost because of that. So in close elections, that matters. I saw in Iowa, there was a battle over 70,000 absentee ballot applications that were filled in and then they got thrown out. So, in these tight races, close races where you have active voter suppression by the right wing could impact these close races. So that's the one caveat I would say. Biden has to win by a big margin to overcome those hurdles.
So one of the things that was an interesting moment, you know, when Biden said, I'm the guy who beat the socialist. And he was responding to a Cuban American, right, during that town hall, who brought up the socialism question. And I'm curious how much the, like that, you know, Dems always hold that the Cuban American vote as incredibly like sacred. How much is that how powerful is that vote? How important is it to be running as someone who really condemns socialism? How could Biden or anyone in that position, like, what's the response to a question like that?
And just to add, but piggyback on that question, is it true that Dade County's in play? Like, a lot of Republicans are claiming that.
Look, I mean, the reality of the Cuban vote is, first of all, the Hispanic population of Florida over the last, you know, two decades has diversified tremendously. You have all those displaced Puerto Ricans, for example. Right. They're U.S. citizens. They're allowed to vote. And they tend to tilt heavily Democratic. And Bernie did quite well in Puerto Rico, right? So you have an influx of Latin Americans. South Americans. And it's a mix. They're middle class. South Americans tend to be more moderate, right? But working class, like poor South Americans, come over, tend to be more progressive. So you have a much more diverse Hispanic population. And first of all, younger Cubans are much more Democratic than their parents or grandparents, right? So the Cuban vote is not monolithic, and the adherence to kind of the anti-socialist piece is very diminished. So I think that's a kind of a retrograde way to look at it. But look, Florida, I mean, the Republicans are very good at suppressing the vote. I mean, for example, disenfranchisement. I mean, the ex-felon bill that allowed ex-felons to restore the right to vote, Republicans undermined it and imposed a poll tax, which I thought was unconstitutional, but apparently not anymore. So, I mean, so the Republicans have done everything they can to restrict people's rights to vote. And that's the kind of thing in close races. They win these close races in Florida because of they know that if they actually let anybody want to vote, in terms of changing registration, a friend of mine has been in Florida during the pandemic, and you have to have lived in Florida for a very long period of time to vote. You can't be a New Yorker, a snowbird New Yorker coming down. But bottom line is that the Hispanic community in population in Florida is much more diverse than it was. Right. The Cuban community is more Democratic than it used to be. And, but look, Biden's playing to the middle. He's playing to the moderate. Sure, yeah. So that's Bernie would have had a very different answer to that question. But I did have one response back on the primary. I know running out of time here, but I have one comment before we departed on that. One thing I would say about the primary is, we ran a really good campaign. Bernie ran a really good campaign, inspired a lot of people. And the only reason Bernie didn't win the nomination fundamentally was Deus Ex Machina, which is, it took an incredible, unprecedented event of Buttigieg and Klobuchar dropping out before Super Tuesday, endorsing a candidate to stop by Bernie from winning. I mean, that has never happened in the history of presidential primaries in this country, where before a major election, you had two of the top five candidates dropping out. And by the way, they had more delegates than other candidates who didn't drop out, endorsing the one candidate to stop another one. Never happened before, and it worked, right? It worked. And that's one of those things, coulda, woulda, shoulda. It's like, that's never happened before. Nothing from the Bernie campaign we could have done to stop it. And to Biden's credit, it worked, right? I mean, his shuttle diplomacy, however he did it, paid off. Because they learned from the Republicans in 2016, if you don't stop the outsider from winning in the first round, then they just steamroll with momentum to the nomination. So that's kind of my perspective. And so, and I just think
that the Republicans allowed to kept the vote split too, right? And they never wised up, yeah.
Then that's the difference, right? They dropped out too late, where this time Democrats said, "Oh man, we're doing everything we can." And normally, it's funny, the Democratic Party typically acts like the Republican Party in 2016. We don't get our we don't all fall in line, but this time it stopped us. But anyway, I think I think at the end of the day, Biden's in a good place and we're all supporting him as Democrats, and Bernie's strongly supporting him. And we all know what's at stake, which is we can't afford four more years of Trump. So that's, and that's the thing that people have to talk about. Oh, you know, is Biden inspiring or motivating? You know, what's motivating? Anger is a very powerful motivator in life and in politics. And so, right, if our base is motivated to vote out Trump, then that's fine. That'll work. And that's kind of like my bumper sticker, yeah, slogan for Joe Biden. Joe Biden, he's fine, right? He's I mean, you know, people like him, they don't love him. They think he's qualified for the job, and he's not Trump. He's fine. And so, and hopefully that should be enough to carry him to victory on election night.
Is it easy to trace, like, how much did polls reflect the role of the media? Like, were you able to see a link between, I don't even know if you look at this stuff, if you look at like data of number of times someone appears on this show and negatively or positively, do polls reflect the media's preferences for certain candidates? Or basically I'm asking if the media bias was borne out in polls.
It can be. I mean, look, I mean, in politics, right, paid media tends to have a bigger influence, except for in presidential campaigns when it's more limited, right, of an impact, because voters are consuming more information, they're following more closely, they have more stronger opinions about it, versus, you know, Senate race, congressional race, right, where voters get very little information from our media. Look, it absolutely depends on the race and the candidate, but you know, Canada has a breakthrough moment, right? And I mean, we definitely looked at it carefully in the primary, where Biden got a lot of really good coverage on his launch, and he gained a lot of votes. Eventually, came down. Bernie got some boost, but not to the same degree. You know, and you look at the impact that earned media events have. But we looked at like how much airtime each candidate got. And no, I mean, for example, the primary, Bernie had a lot of naysayers on MSNBC, where a lot of Democrats watch, and that's not helpful, right? And so, no, absolutely. And Warren got a lot of positive treatment on MSNBC, and that absolutely helped her. So it totally has a major impact on the presidential campaign, absolutely. Again, Trump manipulates the media all the time, right? I mean, media says, oh, we're going to hold him accountable, but then he pulls out of a debate and then hosts a town hall, yeah, and they cover it, right? And so it's like, well, no, wait a second. You're letting a guy who, you know, basically probably exposed a bunch of people to COVID, didn't follow the rules, pulls out of the debate, and then you're rewarding him because what are the big, large conglomerates that own our media companies are about ratings and making money ultimately, and they're not about holding anyone accountable or getting to the truth. So that's, at the end of the day, Trump, you know, has the media, plays them like a fiddle every time. They say, oh, we're going to do this, we're holding accountable, but they can't help themselves. And so, you know, and that's where, like, I learned it from my lesson in Howard Dean and working for Bernie. Average voters are very critical of the media, and they don't like the media. And if you push back on the media like Trump does, like Bernie, like Howard Dean did, voters respond. I remember the great moment of the Dean campaign, when we saw early on he had potential, was he's getting, that was at the end. But at the beginning, when he was at, low single digits, he shows up on Tim Russert, you know, may rest in peace, on Sunday talk show. And Tim Russert just was so aggressive and attacking him, and Dean was defensive and just pushing back. And as a conventional viewer of that, you say, oh my God, Dean did horribly. But we raised so much money, right, from, and we said, oh my God, we're onto something here. When you push back on the media and you can actually get a response from voters who are frustrated with how politics usual. Bernie did the same thing, but when Bernie was critical of the media, we raised money. And he's in both, he was right. He's right to be critical of the media. No, he suffers from it because then he gets negative coverage from, editorials all go against him, right? I mean, our conventional media coverage, Washington Post, New York Times, tends to be very dismissive of him and critical of him and the natural. But our, you know, Bernie's voters weren't avid New York Times or Washington Post readers, but it hurts. It makes it harder. It makes the hill steeper to climb for, yeah, someone like Bernie. And Trump just overcame that with just sheer like celebrity, like overwhelming with media coverage. He just got overwhelming media coverage, and he just, it just didn't, and it, his relationship with the media is kind of unprecedented, and it doesn't matter. But anyway, so that's been my experience with the media. It has a huge impact and absolutely a determinative effect on these elections. And you know, it's not a simple way to answer that or solve that problem.
Yeah.
Ben, thank you so much for coming on, and hope you're right on election night, and check in with you again some other time.
Yeah.
Okay. Thanks for having me. Appreciate
thanks.
It.
Thanks so much. Take care. Bye.
That was great.
It was. Yeah.
He polls well with me.
He polls well with you.
Yeah. That was great. It was great.
I mean, every indication is that Biden's going to win.
Yeah.
Right. And although I can't say that I saw the Hillary loss coming last time. The only thing, I mean, I guess there's two things, right? There's the suppression angle, which could be real, and then there's just the question of like how many people are really going to turn out to vote in person in the middle of a pandemic, and I just don't have a strong sense of what that reality is. So.
But they'll lean Republican.
They for sure will, but just how much, right? So
and
we don't know.
I hope they don't show up without masks. It's going to be a spreader, super spreader election.
Yeah.
They do.
Anyway, he was cool and huge week in the news.
Yeah, we'll just have to wait and see. By the time this comes out, there will have been a debate.
That's right. Yep. Rate and review us. Follow us.
Buy mugs. And
buy mugs. Smash and that like button.
Smash that subscribe button.
Thanks for tuning in. And we'll see you next week.
Great. Bye.